Cantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Mother of All Degrassi, a memoir by Linda Schuyler, narrated by Robin Siegerman. I used to think I must be the strangest person in the world, but then I thought, there are so many people in the world. There must be someone just like me who feels bizarre and flawed in the same ways I do. Well, I hope that if you are out there, you read this and know that, yes, it's true. I'm here, and I'm just as strange as you. Rebecca Martin, age 17, a Degrassi fan. Quote, often attributed to Frida Kahlo. Introduction. January 28, 2020. In a converted 1940s movie theater, I am looking out at row upon row of upturned faces. Wilfrid Laurier University has invited me to speak to students at their Brantford campus as part of their People Make History series. Outside, the sun is lemon yellow and looks warmer than it is. Inside, it's Q&A time. Earlier today, I gave my first talk, Head On, Reflections on Life, about my childhood as a British immigrant growing up in small-town Ontario, my teen years during the 1960s, my work as a junior high school teacher, and my long career in the film and television industry. I have just finished my second lecture, The Degrassi Story, which focused on the origins and cultural impact of my life's work and passion, the Degrassi franchise. Right now, I am enjoying the conversations that have me reflecting on how my filmmaking life has simultaneously been a teaching life, spent with and for young people. For years, I shied away from identifying as a schoolteacher, wrongly thinking of it as a second-class job, an irony that isn't lost on me in this brightly lit lecture theater. Then a student asks me if there is a simple theme that resonates through each episode and every Degrassi series. I think for a moment. I've already waxed eloquently, I hope, about youth empowerment and the inclusive Degrassi message that you are not alone. I've discussed Degrassi's goal of being fearless about subject matter without ever sensationalizing or trivializing. I've talked about the importance of celebrating diversity and have mentioned the cornerstone of each story, that young people make their own choices and live with the consequences. These are all ideas I have articulated many times, in boardrooms, production studios, outdoor cafes, and press interviews. But there is, I realize, something else. There is my own story that I told earlier, how, as an 8-year-old immigrant to Canada, I was mocked and tormented by my grade 3 classmates. My plummy British accent was constantly mimicked.
Ooh, listen to Limey Linda, Slimy Limey Linda. Need to go to the loo, Lindy Loo? Ha ha ha!
And worse, they would chant, Hey, Brit girl, yes, you shit girl, go back to where you came from. Recalling these voices, I shudder slightly, even 65 years later. Then I think of the numerous Degrassi bullying stories I have told over the years. Joey with Yick and Arthur, Dwayne and Tabby with Joey, the Mean Girls and Spike, Spinner with Rick, Craig and his dad, Paige with Manny and Ashley, Holly J and everyone, Bianca, Owen and Fitz with Adam, Maya and cyberbullies, Lola and the Shamers. The list goes on. There's an expectant hush in the air as I collect my thoughts. Finally, I say, I consider Degrassi to be probably the world's longest-running anti-bullying campaign. On the drive home that night, Highway 403 is dark, the taillights of the preceding cars light my way, and I have time to think, to review, the day and my life. I realize what an incredible opportunity I've had for almost 40 years to tell stories for and about young people and to share these stories with audiences in Canada and around the world. As the lights of the city begin to appear on the horizon, the volume of traffic increases. I move deftly from one lane to the other and smile to myself, recalling a time when I couldn't drive on the highway without having a panic attack. And before that, there was a point when I was convinced I'd never get behind the wheel again, when I feared I had lost my eyesight. I was 20 then, and recovering from a terrifying car crash that had come close to taking my life. Following that defining moment, I made a series of choices that, by age 25, convinced me that my life was nothing but a string of disappointments, accidents, and poor judgments. These feelings of failure were amplified by my being the eldest child of immigrant parents. I was expected to succeed. Despite these early setbacks, and more to come, I managed somehow to be on stage tonight with an audience that seemed eager to hear my story. And that wouldn't have happened if, in 1974, I hadn't realized my life needed a serious reboot. For 4 years following my crash, more on that later, I had tried my best to be an engaging teacher for my grade 8 students and a good wife to my high school sweetheart, but my life was on autopilot. I was stalled. As part of my fresh new start, I returned to university to complete my degree. While there, I found a small notice that I thought would change my life. Ultimately, it did. It didn't give me the immediate outcome I wanted, but, like so many pivotal moments in my life, it gave me the result I needed. Chapter 1. Between Two Worlds. April, 1974. I was sprawled on a moth-eaten sofa with my eyes riveted to a portable screen. Around me, my fellow students, sitting on the floor and on various mismatched pieces of furniture, were equally enthralled. We watched shot after shot as hundreds of infantry and artillery groups marched in rigid formation to salute Hitler. The film was Triumph of the Will, a 1935 documentary by female director Leni Riefenstahl, part of the curriculum for our Women in Film course at a young Innes College. Innes College, part of the University of Toronto, U of T, was situated in a once grand Georgian house, which had been the home of Canada's first Prime Minister, Sir John A. Macdonald. Rumor had it that Sir John A.'s spirit haunted the building, and many students claimed to have seen the apparition of a man in a frock coat slipping quietly through the second floor. Now, over 100 years later, the exterior of the house remained grand, but the interior was shabby. Our film classes were held in the original living room. It had elegant proportions, but had been retrofitted with cheap wall-to-wall carpet in an off-putting shade of green. Our professors would set up the 16mm projector in the middle of the room and throw the images to the portable screen parked in front of the defunct fireplace. Here we would watch movies, revel in the magic of celluloid, and rigorously debate the politics of filmmakers and filmmaking. Suddenly, the image in front of us froze. For a moment, hundreds of Hitler Youth were stopped with their boots raised in perfect unison. Then quickly, the image evaporated, burnt by the heat of the bulb, leaving only a bright white light on the screen. "Damn," muttered our Professor K. Armitage, as she rushed to turn off the projector. "I'll get this spliced back together and we can finish the screening next class. Then we will have a discussion, and I assure you, it will be lively." As I headed out of class, my mind was swirling with what we had just watched. Evidently, Riefenstahl had about 30 cameras at work and a crew of over 150 to capture the 1934 Nazi Party rally at Nuremberg, attended by over 700,000 Nazi supporters. That's a huge responsibility for any director, particularly a neophyte 32-year-old woman, only a few years older than me at the time. Riefenstahl's shots were crisp and innovative, and her use of music and sound highly effective. I was mesmerized by her abilities as a pioneering female filmmaker, yet horrified by her message. Triumph of the Will was blatant propaganda that idealized Hitler and the Nazi Party. I was so deep in thought that I reached the front door without having stopped from my daily routine to check the notice board. I retraced my steps through the foyer and scanned the overcrowded bulletin board. At last, I spied a small notice that intrigued me. TV Ontario is accepting applications for summer interns. When I'd left my full-time teaching job a year earlier, I'd enrolled at Innes College, the only college at the time that offered courses in both cinema studies and women's studies, with the hope that I'd be positioned for a new career in the media. I had dreams of becoming a filmmaker. TV was surely cinema's sassy little sister, and TV Ontario hadn't even been on my radar, but I reread the application details. This could be my foot in the door. I took a quick glance around. No one was watching, so I pulled the small poster down and shoved it in my macrame shoulder bag. Later that night, once my application letter had been carefully drafted and redrafted, I picked up the notice to toss into the garbage. No need for competition, right? But something stopped me. The notice was a public one, not mine to destroy. It hadn't even been mine to remove. The next morning, I mailed my letter and guiltily rehung the announcement. When the return letter arrived, I opened it warily, then threw my hands and the letter up in the air and did a happy dance in my tiny kitchen. I had a job in the media! I excitedly marked my start date on the calendar, 2 months away. My final class at U of T had wrapped up, so I decided to make some money by picking up work as an occasional teacher, filling in at a moment's notice for absent teachers. All students know that an occasional teacher is prime pickings for practical jokes, name-switching, tall tales, and many kinds of ad hoc misery. However, knowing that I had a new career on the horizon, I was in no mood for this and ran a tight classroom, adhering to the lesson plans and suffering no fools. As such, I became a popular supply teacher with the administration and was called to fill in on a regular basis at Earl Grey Senior Public School, an inner-city junior high school in Toronto's East End. Barb McKay, an enthusiastic and charming maverick, was Earl Grey's vice principal. She took particular interest in my ability to keep a class of rambunctious adolescents in check and get some lessons taught, as well as create an atmosphere of fun. As the school year was ending and my start date at TV Ontario loomed, Barb posed a question. Would you consider returning to Earl Grey next year in a full-time position? Politely but firmly, I declined the offer. I had loftier dreams. Well, keep us in mind if things don't work out. As much as I liked Barb and the school, I had no intention of returning full-time to the classroom. In fact, I'd never planned to be a teacher at all. In high school, we'd had little in the way of direction to help us with our post-secondary career options. On my one mandatory visit with a guidance counselor, he cheerfully went over the results of my aptitude test. Well, Linda, from the results of your tests, it looks like you have two exciting career options, teacher or nurse. I couldn't have been less enthused. In fact, I was seriously miffed. For anyone who knew me, nursing was absolutely not an option. Even though my mum, who as a young woman nursed the wounded through the Blitz in London, was a compassionate caregiver, I was not good with sick people. And teaching? Really? Could he think of anything more mundane? Why didn't he suggest astronaut, urban planner, architect, or politician instead? He probably considers those with a Y chromosome the only ones worthy of those jobs, I thought to myself. It didn't even occur to me then that television producer could be an option. But in the fall of 1968, with my hippie travels abruptly ended by my violent car crash and university application deadlines long past, I had no alternative than to enroll in Teachers College,
studying for a profession that I'd scoffed at just a few short months before. With my teaching diploma, I began a 4-year teaching gig in London, Ontario, and took part-time courses at Western University. Now, after a full year at the University of Toronto, I finally had my degree and no desire to return to classroom teaching. I started my summer job at TV Ontario with great enthusiasm. Their offices were located in the same building where the Eglinton subway stop emptied out. Convenient, I thought. A very easy commute. However, once I reported to work on my first day, I realized I wouldn't need to take public transportation again. I was given a production vehicle to drive. I was kept busy driving about the city, delivering script revisions, picking up forgotten props, and taking various directors' cars to be washed. I spent time in the art department, Xeroxing American money and coloring it green. Letter set signs needed to be made and colored pencils required sharpening. But most importantly, I brewed and served endless pots of coffee. Meanwhile, constantly checking the TV Ontario job postings, hopeful to find the key to my new life. Daily, my spirits started to fade. Any suitable jobs were all short-term, offering minimum wage, which was not enough to support a newly separated woman. As summer was drawing to a close, Barb's suggestion of a teaching position in the fall seemed to make sense. The prospect of a full-time salary with summers free to explore my own projects suddenly looked appealing. With hours to spare before the closing of the application deadline, I hastily submitted paperwork for a position at the Toronto Board of Education. A few days later, I was at the home of Mac White, the principal of Earl Grey, for an interview in his stunning North Toronto Rose Garden. Mac was engaging, and the roses smelled intoxicating. I explained to Mac how I wanted to continue pursuing opportunities in the media and wondered if he was open to me trying some experimental media projects with my students. Mac responded, "I'm always open to modern teaching techniques. We can keep this dialogue going once we get the basics established." The job was mine, but Mac was hard to read. I wasn't sure if he was truly open to the potential for media projects or was just being political, but I liked him and was willing to give it a go. I became a homeroom teacher for grades 7 and 8 at Earl Grey, one class in the morning and another in the afternoon. I was responsible for their core subjects, basic English and math. Daily, I reminded myself that this position was only temporary, that I just needed to save enough money before taking the leap to become a freelancer somewhere in the media. But slowly, little by little, my students started tugging at my heartstrings. I'd secretly smile when Florence proclaimed during spelling dictation, "Miss Schuyler, someone's letting off gas!" Or when John Grove, a talented artist, flashed me an incredibly good caricature of myself as I earnestly explained quadratic equations. Both of my classes represented a diversity that I'd not seen before. Growing up in a small town in southern Ontario, diversity was defined by which church you attended. My parents made it very clear that as a Protestant, I could not date a Roman Catholic. As a Presbyterian, I could commingle with United churchgoers and Anglicans. But Baptists were considered marginal and Jews were out of the question. Using today's lens, this narrow-mindedness seems ridiculous, if not much worse. But that was Paris, Ontario in the 1950s and 60s. What a sharp contrast to my new inner-city Toronto classroom, where every day I faced students who represented diversity not only of religion, but also of nationality and skin color. I had students from Greece and Italy, Cyprus, Czechoslovakia, some from Jamaica and other Caribbean countries, and many from Asian countries. Most spoke two languages, English at school and their native language at home. My students appeared to integrate well into the Canadian environment during school hours, then seamlessly adapt to their parents' culture at home. I soon came to realize that these daily juxtapositions were not without tensions. I watched with great interest as my students dealt with their burgeoning adolescence while living the first and second generation immigrant experience. I was reminded of my early years in Canada as a British immigrant when I felt like an other who didn't fit in. Yet, compared to the students, I'd had it very easy. On the surface, at least, I blended. My students shared with me their lunches of curried goat, baklava, spanakopita, and lasagna. They gave me jars of homemade pickled olives, peppers, tomatoes, and beets, and, on one occasion, a bottle of homemade wine. I learned about family customs and traditions so different from my own. Kids stayed after school and shared poems they had written or played a new song on the guitar. Sometimes they just needed to talk to someone to vent their frustrations about their overly strict and restrictive parents. Other times, they needed a quiet and private cry. My students had stories to tell. On one of my trips to the downtown administrative offices of the Toronto Board of Education, Barb McKay introduced me to the head of the audiovisual department, the avuncular and mischievous Lou Wise. Lou had his own budget and was responsible for ordering audiovisual works, films, film strips, etc., and audiovisual equipment. Lou and I quickly became friends, and on one visit, he opened his locked cupboards to show me the inventory of equipment he had amassed over the years. I couldn't believe the treasure trove inside. Not only were there the requisite 16mm projectors, slide projectors, and record players, but there was also a large supply of Super 8 cameras with accompanying editing equipment. But wait, there was more. My eyes grew wide when I noticed he also had some professional equipment: a 16mm Bolex camera, a 16mm Arriflex camera, and a Nagra sound recording system. I casually asked Lou who used this equipment. He said that he used it himself to create some of the board's own audiovisual works. "Have others used this amazing equipment?" I asked cautiously. Sadly, no one has shown an interest. "Ha," I thought, "I have interest." But I knew better than to express that just then. I had the beginnings of a plan that I shared with Barb. With her encouragement, and within weeks of being hired in the fall of 1974, I found myself in front of my principal, Mac White, once again. I took a deep breath and started. "With your support, I would like to make a 16mm documentary on my students as they juggle their two lives in Canada. The school board has all the necessary equipment, so we would only require a modest budget for some film stock and editing. We will use some class time as part of the English program to create a script. I'm willing to work nights and weekends and will involve my students not just as subjects, but as crew. In their own words, my students will document their teenage lives as they juggle their schoolwork and the reality of their immigrant home life. We'll call this Between Two Worlds. So, what do you think?" I exhaled. Mac remained characteristically emotionless. After a moment, he promised he would look into it. I returned to my classroom convinced that my idea was too outside the box and that Mac felt I was a nuisance foisted upon him by his enthusiastic female vice principal. I needed to reconcile myself to the reality of traditional teaching and adhere to the prescribed curriculum. One gray day in early November, towards the end of a long afternoon, I was buzzed in my classroom and asked to come to the principal's office. It doesn't matter how old you get or how experienced in life, there is something about a summons to the principal's office that conjures up feelings of wrongdoing. I checked my desk to confirm my lesson planner was up to date, found my attendance register to make sure it was correctly filled out. Sometimes I'd forget. And checked my clothes and my hair. I felt like I was heading for a termination. Mac met me with a pleasant smile, revealing nothing. "Close the door," he said. "Linda, as you know, Prime Minister Pierre Trudeau is a strong believer in multiculturalism."
"I am aware, yes."
I knew that in 1971, Prime Minister Trudeau had announced multiculturalism as an official government policy intended to preserve the cultural freedoms and contributions of diverse ethnic groups in Canada. Well, Matt continued, Trudeau's government has provided pockets of money around the country to further this agenda. As luck would have it, I have one of these pockets. I would like to fund your proposal. And then he gave me a real smile, one that said he was proud of himself and excited about this opportunity. Holy shit! My first professional pitch! My first green light! Then I panicked. There wasn't even a script yet. Well, I assured myself, my students and I could make that happen. But more worrying, I had no idea how to use a 16mm camera or a Nagra, even if Lou Wise could lend them to me. I needed to call the Toronto Filmmakers Co-op. Founded 3 years earlier, in 1971, and loosely based on a similar cooperative in New York City, the Toronto Filmmakers Co-op was an early gathering spot for up-and-coming Toronto filmmakers. Housed in an old Victorian house on Jarvis Street, they offered access to information on government funding, held private screenings, facilitated networking, although I don't think we called it that in those days, and offered some basic production courses. I signed up for a weekend course with cinematographer Carol Betts. Carol had distinguished herself as the first woman in Canada to make her living as a director of photography, specializing in news, sports, and documentaries, an amazing feat considering this was the mid-1970s. Even to this day, male cinematographers far outnumber women. Carol was a pioneer, a skilled craftsperson, an awesome role model, and a great teacher. In one weekend, I studied ASA, sprockets, depth of field, wide and long lenses, film stock, and emulsion. I learned how to load and unload 100-foot reels of negatives and prepare them for the lab. I was ready to face Lou Wise. Lou was delighted with my newfound knowledge and the fact that I actually had money to make a documentary. He furthered my education with a tutorial on his lighting package and one on the Nagra sound system. He agreed to loan me the equipment. Now it was time to share the project with my students. My classes excitedly embraced the challenge to prepare their own personal stories about living between two worlds. We collected their anecdotes and strung them together in a rough script. We brainstormed what images could support these individual stories. I gave my students crash courses in lighting and sound, as it would be their job to support me while I gathered the pictures. Over the course of a few months, we gathered footage at local ethnic festivals and events, at the Greek Orthodox Church, at Kensington Market, on the Danforth, in Chinatown, in Little Italy. I arranged for my class to take a skiing trip, and we documented some of my students experiencing skiing and snow for the first time. We shot at local hockey games, in the schoolyard, at school dances, and at the neighborhood restaurant hangout. Fofo, one of my Greek students, loved to be in front of the camera, but refused to take her coat off. I later realized that she didn't want her parents to see her school clothes. She had her own sexy image for school, and she knew her parents would not approve. She changed in the washroom every morning and afternoon. Later, when I was developing Degrassi Junior High, Fofo's wardrobe would become an inspiration for the character Stephanie Kay. Towards the end of the shoot, with help from Lou, I arranged for two sync sound interviews, one with Sylvia Pusey, a passionate and compassionate teacher, herself a longtime Jamaican immigrant, and the other with one of my students, Donald Hoppy, a very recent immigrant. Both interviews went well, but the end of the Donald interview wouldn't leave my head. Donald and his twin brother, Ronald, had immigrated from Jamaica a few months earlier. The Hoppy boys had never seen snow before and were delighted and awestruck when they participated in our special skiing field trip. They were charming kids who obviously came from a caring home. In my interview with Donald, I'd asked him what he liked about Canada. "I just like it here," he smiled. My dad and mom both have jobs, and they are happy. Is there anything you don't like about Canada?
Yep, it's cold.
But you seem to have such a great time on our ski trip.
Oh, that was fun, real fun, and cold.
He cracked a smile. Then I asked if he had ever experienced any difficulties fitting into his new environment at Earl Grey. As both he and his brother were forever flashing their million-dollar smiles and readily being accepted in new friend groups, I expected an upbeat answer that could sit nicely towards the end of the film. I wasn't prepared for what I got. Donald started to recount a situation that had happened a few days earlier at lunchtime. He was hanging out in the local corner restaurant with a bunch of other kids when someone called him out, used the N-word, and ordered him to shut the door. As he repeated the racial slur on camera, I asked him how the incident made him feel.
"I felt so stupid. I want to be white," was his response.
I looked at Donald's beautiful face and couldn't reconcile how such a wonderful young man would want to be anything other than who he was. I took myself back to the Toronto Filmmakers Co-op in search of an editor. Here, I met the talented Clark Mackey, who had recently won an award for his documentary on Ontario's healthcare system. Clark and I spent hours with the footage, back and forth, hanging scenes in the trim bin, naming and labeling moments, looking for gems. Following the script, we had a basic shape for the film. We showed joyful celebrations of various students' cultures. We heard some of their challenging anecdotes about living between two worlds. And, finally, we culminated the project with a montage of students celebrating together in Canadian activities such as playing hockey, skiing, and attending a school dance. As per the script, Donald's interview came in the middle section of the film. But it gnawed at me that this didn't seem to do justice to his story. I faced my first crisis as a documentary filmmaker. I wondered if this moment was too intimate to remain in the film. Would Donald be uncomfortable seeing his raw words shared with others? If I keep the interview, should I leave it buried in the middle of the show, or should it be repositioned? After much soul-searching, I decided that not only should the interview stay in the film, but it would be the very last image. This was a departure from the original shape of the script and was a pivotal moment for me. I learned firsthand that the editing process was, in a sense, the final draft of the script. I liked the new order. It was very powerful, but it created a deep question. By positioning the interview at the end, was I being sensational for the wrong reasons or provocative for the right ones? I didn't want to be manipulative, as I had seen in Triumph of the Will, yet I wanted to raise awareness. I sought the advice of my sage friend, Sylvia. "Leave the interview where it is," she said emphatically. "We must leave people thinking and get them talking. You've made the right choice." With that encouragement, I shared the cut with my class, including Donald. We had a lively and raw discussion that ultimately led to the same conclusion. The picture was locked. Not only did it end with Donald, but the final image was a long freeze on his face, allowing the moment to linger. We screened the finished project with family, friends, faculty, and various members of the Toronto Board of Education in spring 1975. Even though the ending was thought-provoking, they praised the even-handedness and inclusiveness of the project. The board quickly prepared an in-depth teacher's guide to accompany the film. Multiple copies were ordered to be distributed around the city, activating many discussions on multiculturalism and racism. Eventually, our documentary was distributed to most major school boards across the country. I felt like a star. My kids felt like stars. We were responsible for opening dialogue from coast to coast. It was a heady feeling for all. One day, near the end of the school year, I was once again summoned to the principal's office. On this occasion, thoughts of termination did not cross my mind.
I knew Mac White was happy with our project and enjoyed the positive attention coming to Earl Grey and to him. Mac greeted me with his characteristic pleasant smile, revealing nothing. "Close the door," he said. "Linda, you know we are all very proud of you and your students for the great film you have made."
Oh, I sensed a but coming.
"Well, we are not the only people who are proud of your work. NBC would like to air it."
Mac couldn't contain his joy any longer. After a brief pause for this to sink in, Mac and I began laughing together. The Toronto Board of Education had given its permission. Our project and our school were going to be featured on a major U.S. television network before the end of the month. How great was this for a first-time filmmaker? As the air date drew closer, we were told by the network that Between Two Worlds wouldn't be shown in its entirety, but a good number of minutes would be featured. Members of the staff gathered together for the broadcast occasion. Our film was part of a 60 Minutes type of show, looking at race relations and racism in the U.S. and included a portion about Canada. We watched some rather unsettling interviews about the state of racism south of the border. However, we remained excited about our section. Then the announcer's voice sounded. Coming up, after this short break, a look at racism in the North. There's a time bomb ticking in Toronto. We all looked at each other, stunned. The commercial seemed to last forever. Then finally, we saw scenes from Between Two Worlds. Familiar footage, but in an unfamiliar order. All the balance and all the joy had been stripped from the show, leaving only the tough moments, ending with the Donald Hoppe interview. No context, no explanation. I was devastated. I felt betrayed. My students' trust had been violated, their voices exploited. I wanted to sue. I wanted to cry. In the end, there was nothing to be done. NBC had received the correct permission to use the footage. The copyright was owned by the Toronto Board of Education. All the clearances were in place. There was no foul play, just sensational editorial judgment. Wow. I'd witnessed firsthand how context matters. I saw how the same footage juxtaposed in a different way could make an entirely different statement. In Between Two Worlds, we saw Donald as a charismatic teenager, laughing with his friends and playing in the snow. We also saw him as the vulnerable boy who had been cut by racist remarks. He came across as an engaging young man who had been deeply hurt by a spiteful comment. But in the NBC version, without context, Donald came across as a sorry victim. This difference would stay with me throughout my career. In Degrassi, I've constantly tried to keep our stories thought-provoking and authentic, not sensational nor manipulative. Despite my dismay at having my footage misused, the powers that be in the Toronto Board, and even in my own school, did not share my outrage. They continued to bask in the glow of a national U.S. broadcaster being interested in the material. My project had succeeded on many levels. As time went on, and the school year yielded to summer holidays, the sting of the NBC experience started to fade. I reflected on how lucky I'd been to work in a school where the principal and vice principal were supportive of my ideas and projects, and how blessed I was to have such amazing students. Years later, after I had left teaching, Barb revealed to me that it was a serendipitous day when I'd arrived as an occasional teacher at Earl Grey. The year before, she and Mac had been specifically dispatched to Earl Grey, as Barb puts it, to happy up the domain of an old school martinet who had ruled Earl Grey with the four R's of education: reading, writing, arithmetic, and rules. The neighborhood had been changing. Immigrant families, low-income housing projects, and group homes were moving in beside ambitious yuppies and proud gay couples.
Earl Grey needed to be part of the change, and Barb and Mac were carefully staffing their faculty to meet these evolving times. One of their first hires, the year before me, was a young man with energy and fresh ideas, Bruce Mackey. Bruce, a born teacher with a cocky attitude and large personality, had rocked the rigid rule of his previous principal. But Bruce was exactly who Barb and Mac wanted on their team. It was no surprise that in a very short time, Bruce and I became friends. I met Bruce at lunch in the staff room at Earl Grey. It was my first day as a full-time teacher, and I was still feeling disappointed that my job at TV Ontario had not turned into a new career. I was also trying to come to terms with my new separated status. Plus, I was tired. I had walked for over an hour and a half that morning. The transit workers were on strike, and I'd had no other way to get to work. Feeling cranky, I distanced myself from the other teachers by burying my head in a novel. But Bruce Mackey would not let my book stop him from trying to strike up a conversation. When he found out that I had walked to work, he insisted that from that afternoon on until the end of the strike, which would turn out to be a record 23 days, he would pick me up and drop me off daily. And he did. Every morning, Bruce would pick me up at my modest beach house, waiting to be sold as part of my divorce settlement, in his 1970 red Mustang. As the school librarian, Bruce embraced my Between Two Worlds project. He gave me tremendous support, both professionally and personally, and became my driver, cheerleader, and general assistant. After the NBC airing of Between Two Worlds, Bruce and I enjoyed a beer on the patio of the Red Lion, a popular hangout of ours in a rambling old Victorian mansion just up the street from the Toronto Filmmakers Co-op. I shared with Bruce how so much of my life had changed in the previous 2 years, mostly for the good. But regardless of the changes, I couldn't shake the fact that I was a failure. Bruce already knew about my first failed attempt at university, my aborted international travels, and my ongoing divorce, but he had no idea how my parents had responded to the disintegration of my young marriage. I told him about the night I'd called them with the news that Brian and I were separating. They rushed to Toronto in record time, as if by getting there immediately they could change the outcome. After they hugged me and we shed a few tears, they told me that I had made a sacred vow before God and divorce was a sin. Yikes! I'd known that my folks would be disappointed, but I wasn't ready to hear that God also saw me as a failure. "So you see," I said to Bruce, "it's pretty hard to come back from a sense of failure when you have let down your high school sweetheart, your parents, yourself, and God." Bruce looked at me as if to say, "You done now?" He took a swig of beer and started in. "Schuyler," as he affectionately called me, "you are so not a failure. First, I met your parents the night of the premiere of Between Two Worlds. They looked and sounded like very proud parents to me. And secondly, I've been with you. I've watched you work. I see what you've done for your students. You give them a platform to let their voices be heard. You've become their champion."
I have to admit, that does feel good.
I nodded and started to smile. Bruce laughed.
Damn right you should feel good.
I'm not a disappointment.
I chuckled as I took a swig of beer.
What did you say? Bruce asked mockingly. I didn't hear you.
I'm not a disappointment,
I shouted back, turning heads from adjacent tables.
Totally not a disappointment.
Bruce stood up and spoke loudly to those around us.
This young lady just made a killer documentary and she's going to do more. Cheers,
he said as he raised his glass to slight applause and bemused smiles.
And, Bruce laughed as he sat down, tonight, we're going to celebrate your current success. We're going dancing.
But I'm enjoying being here at the pub, I protested.
Nope, we're leaving, Bruce said. You deserve some fun. And You might even learn a little bit more about me.
He winked. That night at Chaps, while line dancing and laughing, I let the joy of my first film wash over me. Bruce encouraged me to keep dancing. He was happier than I'd ever seen him before. He brazenly sidled up to various folks, challenging them to dance faster and longer. It was almost as though he were in a trance. At some point, well after midnight, I saw Bruce at the far end of the bar, intimately chatting with another man. I signaled that I was getting a cab. I thought he might disengage and offer to drive me, but no, he sent me an air kiss and waved me goodnight. As I settled into bed for the night, my head spun. I knew that over the last few months, I'd done some good work, not just for Earl Grey and my students, but for me as well. I felt as though I was finding my voice, and it wasn't about me. I realized that by listening and observing, I could give a voice to others. I wanted to do more. As I drifted off to sleep, I thought about Bruce and the message he had sent me. In his unique way, he had confirmed to me his unspoken sexuality. Through him, I was about to get a window into the tumultuous world of the 1970s and 80s gay scene in Toronto.
Chapter 2. My Queer Education. Bang, bang! Someone was pounding on my front door. With one eye half open, I checked the clock. 3:14 a.m., seriously? Bang, bang, bang! With both eyes wide open, I grabbed my house coat and cautiously approached the door of my one-bedroom apartment. I'd moved there a couple of years ago after my ex-husband and I had sold our beach home as part of the divorce settlement. My apartment was on the ground floor of a detached house in the West End. The dwelling had been divided into three units. I knew both my fellow neighbors were home because I'd heard them each return at different times this Saturday night. The drug-addicted ophthalmologist shortly after midnight, and the shy, stoop-shouldered university student just before 2 a.m. We had a code. If I hit the ceiling or floor with a broom in a particular manner, they would come. We were not close, but we looked out for each other. Bang, 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 bang! I peered through the small window in the top of the old oak door and saw him. Actually, at first, I didn't really see him. I saw blood. Blood on the forehead, blood over the left eye, blood running down the cheek. Then I saw more. Tears in both eyes. A mouth pinched in pain. And I knew who it was. I opened the door and all 5'7" of Bruce fell into my arms, sobbing. I hugged him. Somehow, we maneuvered our way into the living room and turned on the lights. The sight was not pretty. "We're going to the ER," I said.
"No, we're not. You know I can't do that."
"I can't fix this."
"Yes, you will. You always do."
I was now in my third year of teaching at Earl Grey, and Bruce and I were close friends. I had become well aware of his various weekend trysts. We headed to the bathroom, pulled out the first aid kit, and began the cleanup. I am not a nurse, but I did my best. Once I got most of the blood off, it didn't look so bad. Though there would be some swelling around the eye, the superficial cuts would heal soon. But Bruce's tears, I couldn't remove those. His tears were not about the pain from his bleeding head. They were about the pain of a double life. He told me he'd been beaten up. He and his one-night stand, both high on poppers, had had sex in his car. The scene had turned ugly, from sex to violence propelled by their mutual self-contempt. The next Monday morning, I marched my homeroom class into the library for their scheduled session. The librarian, Mr. McKee, was sporting a vibrant black eye.
"Silly me," he laughingly shared with my class. "I had an argument with my kitchen door. The door won."
Bruce and I exchanged surreptitious looks that didn't go unnoticed by our students. For the next 40 minutes,
Bruce was the consummate librarian. He introduced my class to new authors. He read a passage from a YA book that had them mesmerized. He challenged them to pair their personalities with potential books. As the students roamed through the library, he watched carefully. He wanted each student to have a meaningful and positive experience. He was one fine teacher, captivating, endearing, and charming. The kids loved him, and so did I. As my students left the library, heading back to our homeroom, they could not hold back from editorializing on their teachers. What they saw was two young, fun, and single teachers who obviously shared a connection. They stroked their index fingers together, indicating that they knew that Mr. Mackey and Miss Schuyler are in love. Giggle, giggle. Bruce had been brought up by hard-living, tax-paying, blue-collar workers in Toronto's East End. He was the middle of three brothers. As teenagers, they would often be found together in front of the television set watching sports, swigging beer, and screaming obscenities at various officials. Upon leaving secondary school, both his brothers would pursue lives in the trades. Bruce was different. He went to university and got a degree in education. He spoke French fluently and playfully butchered many other languages. He was considered the queer one of the family. Little did they know how queer this queer one really was. Bruce was boisterous and fun, enjoyed his beer and sports, and always insisted everyone have a good time. He described himself to me as a queer queer. Bruce also had a closeted side. Although he admitted his sexuality to a few close friends, he was not out at work, nor to his family, and had no intention of ever coming out to either. He couldn't. The times wouldn't allow it. When Bruce and I would part company on a Friday or Saturday night, I knew the night was not over for him. The weekend was short, and he needed to pack in as much partying as he could. This would often mean a trip to one of the city's bathhouses for a quick hookup, or a stroll through High Park, cruising near the bushes. Our birthdays being just 6 days apart, Bruce and I shared a zodiac sign. We would joke with each other that, as Aquarians, it was our job to change the world. We'd laugh, but both secretly hoped, in our own small ways, we could do just that. Bruce and I would sometimes combine our birthday celebrations, but on the evening of February 5th, 1981, a Thursday, we decided to celebrate Bruce's birthday a day early. He had plans for the weekend that he didn't want to share. I got the sense that he might be seeing someone. I really don't remember much of that birthday celebration. More than likely, it included a few beers at the Red Lion. But I remember the next day, vividly. Having left teaching a couple of years earlier, I was at work in my home office. Bruce called me from the school phone and in a hoarse whisper said,
"Schuyler, have you seen the news? It's terrible. The police, they raided the baths. It's a travesty."
Then he added in an even quieter voice,
"I was supposed to meet someone there tonight."
I rushed out to get the newspaper, and there, on the front page of the Toronto Star, police arrest hundreds in steam baths. Metro policemen, many armed with crowbars and hammers, swooped down on four downtown Toronto steam baths last night and charged 253 men with being found-ins at body houses. The raids galvanized the gay community. The following night, over 3,000 protesters, gay and straight, gathered at the corner of Yonge and Wellesley Streets to march to the Toronto Police 52 Division and eventually to Queen's Park. They chanted, "No more shit," and "Fuck you, 52. Back in December 1967, a young, edgy justice minister, soon to become prime minister, Pierre Elliott Trudeau, had spoken his now famous words, "There is no place for the state in the bedrooms of the nation." He also went on to say, "What's done in private between two adults doesn't concern the criminal code." Toronto police thought differently. In June, 2 more bathhouse raids occurred and 21 more men were charged. Bruce no longer visited the baths. He did, however, continue his midnight cruises in Hyde Park, until that ended abruptly in 1985. On the morning of Wednesday, June 26th, Bruce arrived at my office early. It was the first day of his summer holidays. He had a folded Globe and Mail newspaper. His manner was agitated and his face grave.
"Read this," he said, as he angrily shoved the paper at me.
"Theft likely as motive for killing," I read.
"Go on," he insisted. "Who was it that was killed? Who? Read on and see who. Read on."
Kenneth Zeller, 40, was found slumped over in the front seat of his car at 12:25 a.m. on Sunday. An autopsy revealed that Mr. Zeller, a librarian at Williamson Road Public School, died of a fractured skull. Okay, I still wasn't sure what to make of it, other than Bruce must know this guy.
"You're not getting it, Schuyler," he said with mounting frustration. "He was gay-bashed, had his skull kicked in because he's a faggot."
In the article, Staff Sergeant Ken Senzura was quoted as saying,
"We believe that a group of 4 or 5 white males are responsible."
He urged witnesses to come forward. No mention of gay-bashing. I questioned Bruce's allegation.
"Don't be so naive,"
Bruce chastised. "I didn't think I was being naive. I was just responding to the newspaper facts." I still had a lot to learn about the gay world and the media. But Bruce knew the truth. He knew from the growing chatter, fear, and anger mounting in the gay community at church in Wellesley. He knew because he lived in fear that could have been him. Months later, when the 5 teenage killers were each sentenced to 9 years in prison, the press coverage would finally talk about a motive other than theft. The Globe and Mail reported in part, "The night of June 21st, 1985. It is the last day of school and the longest day of the year. 8 friends from a Toronto neighborhood, all under 18, decide to celebrate. They get some beer, borrow a truck, and set off. People in a park overhear them planning a visit to Hyde Park to beat up a fag and get money from a queer. And finally, it was there, in black and white." By this time, I not only had left teaching, but had produced several episodes of The Kids of Degrassi Street and was now developing the proposal for what would become Degrassi Junior High. I wanted desperately to reflect some of Bruce's journey through dramatic storytelling. When Degrassi Junior High hit the air on CBC in the late 1980s, we were applauded for our frank and fearless storytelling. We tackled teen pregnancy, suicide, racism, and abortion. Many called us gutsy and groundbreaking. I was proud of the response, but knew we didn't do justice to gay and lesbian storytelling. Yes, we did a storyline with Snake's older brother coming out to his parents, and another where Caitlin questions her sexuality, both considered bold at the time for a teenage audience, but they didn't capture the anguish that I saw in Bruce. The times weren't ready. It wouldn't be till 2003 in Degrassi The Next Generation that we really cracked our storytelling for the LGBTQ+ community. It would take me partnering with a young and ambitious writer, Aaron Martin, to finally tell a story that would do justice to the horror of Kenneth Zeller's death and the pain that was Bruce's. Over time, the Degrassi writing team broke other critical LGBTQ+ storylines that would have done Bruce proud. Stories exploring the sexuality of young people, some gay, some lesbian, some questioning, some bi, some gender fluid, and some trans. One of our boldest LGBTQ+ storylines, and one I wish I could have shared with Bruce, was that of Adam Torres, played by Jordan Todosi. We first introduced Adam in season 10 of Degrassi, The Next Generation, as one of the guys. Audiences soon find out he is a trans male, a male who has been born with a biologically female body. This comes to light when his mother says to him,
Please be Gracie and wear a dress for your grandmother's visit. A lot of research preceded the actual script. We consulted with various members of the LGBTQ+ community and, in particular, Nick Adams from GLAAD. Nick, himself a trans male, headed up the Outreach Education Department for GLAAD, then the Gay and Lesbian Alliance Against Defamation, based in L.A. He was very enthusiastic about our storyline. He had been advocating to see a trans story on television for years. It would be another couple of years before he would be consulted on Laverne Cox's character, Sophia Bursett, in Orange is the New Black. Degrassi TNG's My Body is a Cage was written by Michael Grassi. Michael had joined the writing department only 2 years earlier as our story coordinator. In this junior position, he quickly took the opportunity, somewhat shyly, to pitch himself as a writer and secured himself 2 credits in his first year. By the time he approached us with the pitch for the trans male storyline, he had 7 writing credits and his confidence was growing. His sensitive, warm, and respectful script for My Body is a Cage went on to win a Peabody Award. When we received the award in New York, the citation from the judges read in part, "This episode neither sensationalizes nor trivializes the subject matter." I think that is my favorite citation ever. It embodies everything I want from my show, regardless of the subject matter. That episode was also nominated for a Primetime Emmy in 2012. We didn't win that night, but came away with an even better prize. At the opulent afterparty, My Body is a Cage served as an introduction to Chaz Bono. Not just an introduction, but a commitment facilitated by our publicist, Ian Christensen, to do a guest spot in an upcoming Adam storyline. A few short months later, along with cast members and writers, we entertained Chaz in our lakeside garden. It was one of those magical beach evenings where we enjoyed a barbecue and shared stories. I was particularly fascinated with Chaz's tales about his mother, Cher. Their relationship had been through some rocky times during Chaz's journey, first as a lesbian, a very bad lesbian, as Chaz readily points out, and later when he identified as Chaz. At this point, Chaz said his mother went ballistic and they needed to take some time apart. Now, as he was planning his top and bottom surgery, he and Cher had found a good place. "Oh, yeah," he laughed. "She still gets my pronouns mixed up, but I know she doesn't mean harm. The most annoying things now are the corny messages she sings on my answering machine."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.